on the African continent. The striped polecat, also known as the zorilla and scientifically known as Ictonyx striatus, makes it its home, communicating with its family members and other members of its species through different sounds and screams, as shown here. The zorilla lives in Africa, as stated before, and has a very broad range, spreading from the Mauritanian coast to the Sudan coast, and also all the way down to the South African coast, meaning that it encounters a wide variety of different landscapes, such as the ones shown here. Here is a coastline, and in the middle of Africa, it experiences forest landscapes, as shown here. Now, something that's very important to note is that in all of these landscapes and in all of these habitats and environments, there is a bunch of hiding ground for this small zorilla, which ranges from 48 to 60 inches in length, half of which is covered by its tail. Now, as can be seen in the following clip, it likes to hide in grass. As far as predators go, striped polecats encounter predation from side-striped jackals, as shown in this picture here, predatory birds, as shown in the previous video, and other predatory animals. Now, this obviously helps to keep the population of the zorilla intact and stable. Striped polecats do have ways of defending themselves, including spraying out a bad-smelling odor that helps not only mark its territory, but also deters enemies away from its area and away from it. Now, as shown in this graphic, the spray can reach out as far as 15 feet, which should give the zorilla a decent amount of time to get away from any predators it may see, and it should allow it to be able to get out of any situations it feels it needs to. Now, despite the distinct similarities that striped polecats have to skunks, it can be seen here that they are not really related at all, and that it has been a long time since any common ancestor has existed Now, the striped polecat has a very diverse diet, which includes frogs, snakes, different types of lizards that can be found on the African continent within the zorilla's range, small birds, as shown here, and also they eat the eggs of such birds, as well as different beetles that are spread across Africa. With all of the predators and prey being considered, it leads to an overall food web that starts with the grass and the plants and other producers, then moves on to the second trophic level of the primary consumers, which include the insects and lizards that the striped polecat eat. Then the polecat is at the secondary consumer level. And then, as mentioned earlier, the side-striped jackal and the predatory birds would serve to be the last level on the trophic food pyramid. Now, when compared to the range of the zorilla shown earlier, the zorilla mainly lives in either an arid or a semi-arid climate, depending on the specific part of Africa it is in, but it matches up with commensalistic relationships that zorillas have between both lakes, as they are able to swim well, and trees, which they typically climb up, and they are adapted for these situations by having sharp claws that are specifically good for climbing those trees. Now, it's also important here to notice that still there's a lot of grass and a lot of underbrush that the zorilla can hide in, as also is present here with this tree. Now, the sharp claws obviously help the zorilla to not only climb the tree, but it allows it to find the perfect place to find shade in the arid or semi-arid climate that it is usually in. If an invasive species were to be introduced to the area, or as immigration naturally takes place between species moving into the habitats of the striped polecat, it is clear that the population of the striped polecat would most likely go down. The availability of living space would also go down, as holes in the dirt or rocks or just overall area in general would be taken up by the other species, leading to an increase in competition. Now, this would happen because of the lack of food that there is for the area that's sufficient for multiple species that feed on the same thing, such as competition between the zorilla and the banded mongooses, which are small cat-like carnivores that eat these same insects and same food sources, such as the beetles and lizards, as the striped polecat. Now, it is clear also that if the striped polecat populations went down, insects such as these would have their populations flourishing and they would overpopulate the area. One ecological issue that the zorilla is being faced with is habitat fragmentation and habitat loss due mainly to the spread of farms over the African continent. Now, as these farms spread, it is obvious that the zorilla has less and less places to live, which leads to problems for not only the striped polecat, but also for humans. Now, looking at it from a human's perspective, zorillas are annoying animals that eat chickens, as can be seen here in this picture, as the zorilla is holding a chicken leg. And this has a lot of economic implications, as obviously farms are a main source of money, and chickens lay eggs, which are an important factor in both meals and in being able to sell those eggs, which is another way in which eggs bring in money. So ultimately, the zorilla takes away money from the farmers. However, it's not all about money, because the zorillas are native to that land, or native to Africa. And as the farmers expand their farms further, as I said earlier, their habitats get taken away, and they ended up getting hunted by these domestic dogs, which not only lowers their populations, but the zorillas that are able to escape these dogs, they move on, and it increases competition, similar to the effect of adding an invasive species into their habitat. But instead, in this case, these zorillas are the invasive species. One way that this ecological problem can be solved is by implementing the strategies of using reservations to protect the striped polecat. This is done for more prominent creatures on the African continent, such as giraffes and lions, as shown in this picture here. And it could go a long way in preventing unnecessary competition between zorillas and other species that are maybe native to the specific area. Now, another way that can limit any habitat loss for zorillas is limiting the land or the amount of land to which farmers can have and hold in the continent and in the general area where zorillas are present. Now, there is a limitation to this, as this would be hard to enforce unless law enforcement is there constantly. All of this begs the question of whether or not the striped polecat is a keystone species. To this question, I would say that it is, because the effects of the ups and downs of its population numbers are profound on the population numbers of the species in its food web or chain. For example, if the zorilla population went up, the population of its predators, such as the birds and the side-striped jackals, would also go up. However, if the population of the zorilla went down, the populations of its predators would also go down substantially, and the insects would overpopulate. Now, the larger predators cannot feed off of insects and be sufficiently fulfilled as far as their hunger goes, therefore meaning that the striped polecat plays kind of a balancing act, in that its niche is more of a balancing role in the environment rather than being a predator or a producer.